Hello, thanks for the start of the webinar. My name is Jacob Bonacrax. I'm going to talk about VR in the open source space and the VR open standards. So, a little bit on me. I started actually here in Chalmers, so it's pretty fun to come here. I've started it twice, once as the professional and once the master, just last year actually. And I've been working in FOSS graphics since 2006, I think. Might be 2007, 2008, I can't really remember. It's kind of on that scale. And I also do VR at Clever. And I have a bunch of hobbies and my contact details out there as well. So if you see anything that you find interesting and want to talk to one of me about, just ask. Or just come to me afterwards. So I'm going to start off by talking about OpenHMD, which is a open source project that was actually founded by me and a couple of friends here in Gothenburg. And it was the first consumer VR driver for Linux, at least that we know of. And we started out with the Oculus DK1. And now we support more platforms than that on Linux. So we support a whole bunch of hardware, even on the generic Android menu and all of them. And so it is all mostly donated or contributed by other people. So it's not something that I work on. We can get a little bit on the HTC Vive. I still do a story and then pushed it out of the project when the people just came and added stuff. Because this really is a want for VR and people can do stuff with VR. Just a lot of stuff about OpenHMD. We wrote it in C because we are really programmers. There's a whole bunch of blind solid languages. And people are doing on various whole bunch of there's a lot of things that go into a modern good performance VR driver stack or whatever you want to call it. So people are working on all sorts of hands from different people. So there's a lot of initial work here. But luckily we have a Blender guy who works for the foundation, helped us work for the foundation so we can integrate it. So that's pretty cool. But the most important part, but at least what I think of the OpenHMD is the community that surrounds it. There's a whole bunch of them on IRC hacking on the various different things. Like there's people doing working just on the various controllers and maths. And there's people just creating fibers and yeah, it would be a whole regular hack fest and try to get together and work on it. And the license for the code is that we currently use license because we want most people to use the code. And even if there's a Chinese manufacturer just includes the code into the product and doesn't, that's okay. We can use more people to use it. It's a contribution to the whole world. We care more about it. So a little picture from this is from Foster, and we had a little small hackfest there. So not the most flattering picture of me, and I was taken by our marketing person. So he wanted some nice pictures of us. So yeah, I think we pushed a little bit here, but it was actually a real hackfest. But not everything is unfortunately great. We are a really small actor when it comes to big call. There's not many opportunities to use the system. There's some like Blender, I think VLC also has some stuff. And there's people doing small, fun projects around it as well. But not really. So I'm going to talk about OpenXR, which is a open standard for virtual. Open standard for for an API that can be shared between multiple implementations without any running into problems of getting sued, things like that. So as you might imagine, the problem space looks sort of like this. You have a whole bunch of game engines or applications that some do bindings to various APIs. So each one of these are APIs and there's even more out there, and that's not really as sustainable in the long run. And some of the APIs only support certain hardware. So that's not really fun. So the solution is, of course, you do one API that handles both the applications and various drivers and plugins that you have. So that's where OpenXR comes in. And the good part about this is, you know, there's a whole bunch of companies that are working together on this. It's not just some of them. There's even Microsoft. That's fun. But most of the important people are actually in the working group already doing this. So the whole initiative was actually started by Epic, I think Unity, Valve, Oculus, and Google said that we can't really keep going having four different APIs or something like that. We have to target just one. We actually want to work together. So the most important people are here, and us, of course, from Clever. So I won't really talk so much about the API itself. I'll talk about a little bit why I want to do that in the next slide, but you can get all the devices that are connected to the API. You can get the frame time, because that's very important in VR. You want to produce a frame soon, as close to possible as when those pixels touch into codons for you. And that's all the science doing that. And it does like input and handle things like that. But there's a link there for a talk done by, I think it was Nick, the chef of OpenXR working group at UDC. And it does it a little better. So if you're more interested in the technical things behind the idea, yes, go ahead. So, as I said, the OpenXR is done by a working group, which is called OpenXR Working Group. And we hold both weekly meetings, we also have all the competitors. And the delivery of that working group is a specification, which is both an API and documentation for that specification. But there's also some necessary evil between all these working groups. So we all know about patents, unfortunately. So if you join the OpenXR group, you implicitly say that all of your patents which touch the API will actually be granted to anybody or can be used by anybody. And that's also a member of the OpenXR group. There's some lawyering involved there, setting into an exclusion and everything, but that's the general idea that everybody in the working group will not sue anybody else that actually implement this API. There's also an NDA, so this is one of why I'm super technical about the about the API, because there are actually companies or people that scour the internet for anything that is related to the API, and they will try and patent or extract money from us just by publishing a patent and a ID behind the API, so we can't really talk about them. This is something that actually happened inside of Chrome, well, not inside of Chrome, but two Chrome, but still, they're quite scary. And this also allows a manufacturer to talk about upcoming hardware without having fear of getting leaked to the press or something. And of course, I don't think this is good, or rather, we don't have to do this, but I thought it is the word we're using. It's like this, so that's one of the things that the working group does and allows us to do. And it also allows us to do that for a whole bunch of different APIs. Chronos does, OpenGL and a whole bunch of other APIs, and it has the framework for doing these kinds of work.
So it's a necessary evil, I think, in the world of open source. But I think we can do something good at least here within the what we have in the world, all the patent laws and things like that. Absolutely. So I think I've been going to various conference meetings with students. As well as the Dungeon Graphics. I think it's good because we don't know anybody can even on these APIs create products. We can form communities around this. So I actually have some bonus things. So first off, we are hiring, very clever. If you're hiring, you can also look happy on our pictures here. But we do a whole bunch of stuff in open source, and we really are open first. We do kind of work, we do graphics work and media analytics, so if you even remotely interested in working in open source, I either talk to me directly or my colleague Robert, or just go to link. Compress the picture where I have that should be a link. So then I actually have some questions for you that's been thinking about. Like if there are any faculty here, have you done any courses on open source, or even how are we teaching open source to people? How can we reach out to them more? And how is open source used? Do people just use it as a tool and never think about it, or do they actually get interested in it? And how do we break the mold of open source developers? And I perfectly fit the mold, which I think is a little bit bad, because I stayed at home mostly in the evenings when I went to university, did various programming hacks or whatever projects and stuff like that, and I got involved in FOSS that way. But I don't think that is sustainable. And maybe people like me might not be the best at doing projects I don't know or cooperating. So I think we should something that you should think about how do you bring other people, other kinds of people into the possible. So if you have any questions or things like that, of course, also just please approach me either in the questions sessions or afterwards. So that's it. Any questions? Please feel free to ask.
So I was, when I studied, I took a course about how to melt open source and business.
Okay.
But sadly, it wasn't here. I had to do it in Umeå,
okay.
Which was a bit sad, but at least I could do it. And it was really basic, kind of eye-opening how to, it's nice to do it as a student at home or together with others and put your stuff on GitHub,
yeah.
But how do we make a business out of it so we can pay our rent and so on for
yeah, no, that's a good, that's what Collabra basically does.
Mm.
I think it's too good that people have courses and think that's more something that we should be teaching students.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, it's also becoming more and more popular and people are really something, when Collabra is hiring, we have problems finding people that actually know the source, and the source is a big part of Collabra, so it's a problem that we're trying to work, and we hope we can get involved from the universities, because that's where people create the new generation. Any other questions?
So OpenXR, what is the main goal of it? Is having a standardized API for developing VR applications, or is it?
Yes, so that's awesome. That's a general API that you can develop XR applications with, is VR, AR, and things like that. I think the focus right now is mostly on VR because that's what's mostly out there. And what's actually people can get in there?
Is it really hard to stand out enough since it's such a new field? And I mean, you have what do you call them, the one that's developing an AR?
Definitely. There's sort of like my hardware does this thing. You know?
Yeah.
We have to think about hardware that sometime in the future, because right now we do all that stuff and you know, we can just do it one way, but in the future we might want to do it another way. We might, you know, there's things like light fields technology where you produce a whole bunch of images from slightly different angles and you can actually get images where you can, the eye can focus properly. Like half of the meetings are like people talking about, oh, we have a problem with your eye fatigue is real, so normal headsets has the focus at infinity, and the eye normally likes to focus somewhere around here, so how do you do that? And it's really starts for people like me who are nearsighted, but all the devices are focused at infinity because everything's blurry when put on the device. It's not just APIs. The API is, and the specification is what people will see from this, but there's also a whole bunch of thought and evolution of the API that has to handle the hardware now and also be somewhat forward looking. So, any other question?
So the specification and the vendors are responsible, or are you making sort of an umbrella over other APIs?
We have to interact with certain APIs, but I mean that's good. But still, the actual working group is working on the specification only, and then people also then companies will provide their own driver for hardware. We in Collabora and OpenHD, you know, we want to make an open source stack that people can use for everything. With your permission, I think people can take that and build their own, can make it aware of that and have their own hardware work as an open source device and then have access to all of the applications. So, but yeah, the working delivery of the working group is a specification, not anything else. But, yeah. Any more? So, yeah,
plenty
of times you can keep asking questions.
So,
how much is this used in practice so far?
Sorry?
How much is this used in practice so far?
Do
they still use the, each proprietary?
Yeah, so it's not released yet, and we're working on it. Okay. It's still, you know, we have one for, I think there's one for Oculus Mobile, there's one for Oculus Desktop, and there's one for Daydream, which is Android. There's then Apple AR, and then there's Oculus, and then there's Steam, and then there's one called OS VR, and then there's OpenHD, so there's like 5-8 different APIs. So
was Apple in that group? Or?
Yeah.
Okay,
No, not in that group. I
would be surprised.
Yeah, maybe. It depends on how big they become in the third one. Even Microsoft joining the group, because they don't think really
is the idea that they us out to OpenGL or DirectX or whatever?
There's some interactions between the APIs. So I can't even go into specifics of how it's ID, because I'm not so familiar with other APIs, so I don't know if I'm talking about something new or something old, which is the problem.
But the APIs are how close to the metal are the APIs? So like open computer vision or more like closer to?
It's similar to all the other APIs. I don't think it's closer to hardware than the rest of them. I mean, we try to extract away a certain amount of the hardware.
Okay.
But it's enough
we both had application trackers in the group and we were and homework purpose, so they're both, you know, people can say I would like to program against this and this and this, and then say I would like to provide this and this and this, and then we sort of find what we can do.
There's still a lot of work going on in different companies that have a lot of financial interest in their product being the best experience, right? And how are you in the group seeing feedback from companies like Oculus? And
so Oculus is in there, there's not them, like there's five people on
so their
the
research is piping into
Alexa
as well?
Yeah, so yeah, definitely. And this is the same with the Valve, who does Steam VR and who taught some of the basic hardware behind basic technology behind Steam VR and a whole bunch of, you know, there's also mobile or with Qualcomm and things that does the, you know, phone graphics and things like that, so there's also a consideration of the mobile stuff.
You said there was a patent grant in the group.
Yeah.
But what is your
mapping? Yeah, that's a problem. So it costs a fair bit. For a FA student group, it costs way too much. For a small company, you can have that price, unfortunately. But if you fly on the radar, you probably won't get into trouble, I think, like that. And yeah, but it's unfortunately, the commerce organization needs to exist, and you know, it needs to get fees from the members. That's how the whole feedback loop works. I mean, in the perfect world without patents, you can have commerce. So, yeah.
So you're mainly focusing on open source software, no open source hardware.
Yeah, unfortunately. Well, my hobby project is include open source hardware, but at least from, let's see, from Collabra, we like everything from open source, so if the hardware happens to be open source, that'd be fine. We are mostly a software shop, so we focus on that. From the working group, the working group only focuses on the certification, and then people are free to do whatever.
How do you make cuts?
Sorry,
between MBA and hardware, which is usually sealed and
yeah.
Then you do the API.
Yeah. So. Yeah. So for me, that's a very fine line I have to tread. For people who are, you know, the OpenHRD community, they're not part of Trello, so they don't care. So they just reverse engineer the hardware and, you know, hack or whatever in order to figure out how to work and make it work. Sometimes actually vendors will provide specification for the hardware so we can provide the drivers to them. And we're hopeful that Valve will help out with that regard. Or they will give us the specification on an NDA but allow us to write it right with that open source. So that's what they will try their capacity if they can drive with that size. But I think graphics card, which is my former field or my student field, and it's both Intel and AMD by their own private open source drive for me, so it's really, really good for that. So it's a change. It's getting better slowly. And slowly. Any more questions? People look done, and I think I'm out of time with all these 3 minutes left. Thank you.